Asymptotes of rational functions. In a previous video, we talked about intercepts of rational functions. And in a video before that, we talked about the domain of rational functions. And this is all leading up to a discussion on how do we graph rational functions. The last piece that we are missing is asymptotes. Rational functions have this property that is unique, different from polynomials, and it is asymptotes. Let us zoom in and look. This right here is a rational function that's been graphed. I'm not going to tell you what rational function, just know that it is a rational function. So you're going to notice that there's these dotted lines here. And the graph itself is the teal portion. The teal portion is the graph itself. These dotted lines here are to show tendencies of the graph. So these two, these two right here and right here are what we call vertical asymptotes. Which will get abbreviated as VA from time to time. Vertical asymptotes are lines, they're vertical lines of the form x equals a number. And they're places where the domain has an issue. So in a previous video, when we talked about what is the domain of a rational function, and we took out those values, we found excluded values, we took them out from the domain, and then we wrote our domain in interval notation. My husband texted me and I had my phone open, so it distracted me. Where was I? Got my phone put away. Vertical asymptotes. So vertical asymptotes are places where there's domain issues with rational functions. So in a place where you would be dividing by zero, you can't divide by zero. So there end up being these vertical asymptotes that the function gets really, really close to, but it doesn't touch, right? And it makes the y values go to either positive infinity or negative infinity. The other thing we have is horizontal asymptotes. Horizontal asymptotes talk about the long-term behavior of a graph. So this right here, horizontal asymptote. These are horizontal lines. They're of the form y equals a number. And these horizontal asymptotes tell us as the function goes off the page, how does it tend? It tends towards a horizontal asymptote. So notice on both sides here, as the function leaves the page, it's getting closer and closer to this horizontal asymptote. It'll never actually touch the horizontal asymptote as it goes off, but it will get closer and closer. Now, a graph can pass through a horizontal asymptote, as seen right here. It doesn't cross in the long term. So as it goes off, it won't cross. Vertical asymptotes, on the other hand, rational functions don't cross vertical asymptotes ever. So how do we find asymptotes of rational functions? Well, for vertical asymptotes, for these up and down ones, we factor the numerator and denominator, we cancel any common factors, and then we set the denominator equal to zero and solve for x. This is very, very similar to the domain, the process for domains. Very, very similar. So here's a few notes. One, rational functions never cross a vertical asymptote. Two, what I said up here, they're all of the form x equals a number. And the vertical asymptotes of a rational function are the zeros of its denominator, more or less. We're not going to run into any super complicated cases in this class, but there are some complicated cases out there that aren't exactly, that don't exactly follow this rule. I guess we don't have to worry about them. Horizontal asymptotes. To find horizontal asymptotes, it's a little different than vertical. So for the horizontal, we're comparing the degree of the numerator versus the degree of the denominator. Because both the numerator and the denominator are polynomials, we can find the degree. And depending on the degree of the numerator versus the degree of the denominator, we'll have different horizontal asymptotes. So if the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator, there's a horizontal asymptote at y equals 0. If the degree of the numerator is equal to the degree of the denominator, then there's a horizontal asymptote at y equals the ratio of the leading coefficients. I'll explain in a moment how that works. And if the degree of the numerator is greater than the degree of the denominator, there won't be a horizontal asymptote at all. Wait, I just fixed this page. Wait a second here. Hold on. All right, there. My fixed version had not saved, but it's okay. We fixed it. We got what we needed here. So we'll do a few examples. Let's find some horizontal and vertical asymptotes of some rational functions. So starting with our vertical asymptotes, we're looking at where is the denominator equal to 0 after things cancel. All right, looking at the numerator, I'm going to factor a negative out and make this x negative x minus 3 as opposed to 3 minus x. In a previous video, I talked about this. If you have, If I didn't, here it is. If you have a minus b, this is the same thing as negative b minus a. So you can reverse the order of subtraction by pulling a negative out front. So if I want it to be x minus 3 as opposed to 3 minus x, I make it x minus 3, but I put a negative out front. On the bottom, I have x plus 1 times x squared minus 9 factors into x plus 3 times x minus 3. These x minus 3s cancel, and I end up with negative 1 divided by x plus 1 times x plus 3. My vertical asymptotes are going to happen. Okay, it's getting angry at me now. My vertical asymptotes are going to happen where the denominator is equal to 0. So at x equals negative 1 and at x equals negative 3. I can graph those on my graph. So I have x equals negative 1, so I'm going to negative 1 on the x-axis. And x equals negative 3, which is right here. I feel like this one's crooked, but there we go. So we have x equal to negative 3 and x equal to negative 1. Those are our vertical asymptotes. Our horizontal asymptotes. Those are going to compare the degree of the numerator versus the degree of the denominator. If we look back at our original function here, the numerator has degree 1. The denominator, remembering our trick for finding the leading term of the denominator, we would multiply the highest x power from each factor together. So we have an x and an x squared. X times x squared is x cubed. So the degree of the denominator is degree 3. The degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator. And that means there's a horizontal asymptote. You can look up here. If the degree of the numerator is less than the degree of the denominator, there's a horizontal asymptote at y equals 0. So at y equals 0, that's just the x-axis there. We're not actually graphing the graphs here. We're just simply graphing our asymptotes. So those are the three asymptotes that this graph would have. There's one at y equals 0, and there's two verticals, one at x equals negative 1 and one at x equals negative 3. Now, vertical asymptotes are equations. So are horizontal asymptotes. Asymptotes in general are equations. So you could not just say there's a vertical asymptote at negative 1. It has to be at x equals negative 1. Now, of course, out loud, we're going to say there's a vertical asymptote at negative 1. But as an answer, it's an equation. It has to have the x equals. The horizontal has to have the y equals. Let's look at this next one. All right, so for this one, I'm just gonna go ahead and tell you that the numerator doesn't factor, right? Don't need to worry about the numerator, it doesn't factor. I am going to factor the denominator though, because there is some factoring I can do there. So this could be rewritten as negative 3x squared plus 12. And if I look at it this way, as negative 3x squared plus 12 in the denominator, I can factor out a negative 3. Factoring out a negative 3, I'm left with x squared minus 4. And that can be factored one more time, because x squared minus 4 is a difference of squares. So we have negative 3 times x plus 2 times x minus 2. For the vertical asymptotes, we're looking at where is the denominator 0. So we'll take the denominator, set it equal to 0, set each factor equal to 0, and we get that there's a vertical asymptote at negative 2 and at positive 2. So right here and right here. For the horizontal asymptote, we're looking at the numerator, the degree of the numerator versus the degree of the denominator. The degree of the numerator is 2. The degree of the denominator is also 2. If you look back at our list, when the degree of the numerator and the degree of the denominator are equal, the horizontal asymptote is at a ratio of the leading coefficients. And what that means is we look at this, we look at this guy right here, and we take only the leading coefficients on the top and bottom. So the leading coefficient on top is 2x squared, the highest x term. And the leading term on the denominator is negative 3x squared. So there's a horizontal asymptote at y equals a ratio of those things. So I take the numerator, 2x squared, divide by the denominator's leading term, negative 3x squared. Notice that those x squareds cancel, and we get that there's a horizontal asymptote at negative 2/3. So negative 2/3 is like, you know, I don't know, somewhere in there-ish. Is at y equals negative 2/3. So all in all, we have vertical asymptotes at x equals negative 2 and positive 2, and a horizontal asymptote at y equals negative 2/3. Looking at this last problem, I cannot factor the numerator, it's just 12x to the fifth. In the denominator, I can factor out an x squared and I'm left with x minus 7. For my vertical asymptotes, I'm setting that denominator equal to 0. So I'm getting x equal to 0 and x equal to 7. So x equal to 0, that's on the y-axis. X equal to 7 would put me right over here. For the horizontal asymptote, the degree of the numerator is 5. The degree of the denominator is 3. So the degree of the numerator is greater than the degree of the denominator. And if we look at our list up here, when the degree of the numerator is greater than the degree of the denominator, there's no horizontal asymptote. So all in all, we have vertical asymptotes at x equals 0 and x equals 7, and no horizontal asymptote. Just as a small note, you'll never have multiple horizontal asymptotes with a rational function. There are some functions that'll get two different horizontal asymptotes, not rational functions. One asymptote, one horizontal asymptote, or no horizontal asymptote. That's your only option there. Okay, so those are vertical and horizontal asymptotes. There's one last thing to talk about, and that is oblique slash slant asymptotes. The word oblique and slant mean the same thing. Some people say oblique asymptote, some people say slant asymptote. It's the same thing. It's essentially as if you took a horizontal asymptote and you tilted it. It really is a horizontal asymptote that has been, okay, that line is gone now, that has just been tilted. So instead of it being flat, it's like a slanted horizontal asymptote. The way that we obtain oblique asymptotes is by doing long division. We do polynomial long division. Right. Look at this. This is division right here. We do this division by long division, and then the quotient is the oblique asymptote. Let's do an example of that. And just a few notes. Note one, a function can't have both an oblique and a horizontal. It's one or the other or none. And much like horizontal asymptotes, graphs can cross oblique asymptotes. So they can cross it in the short term, it's just in the long term, they tend towards it. So find and graph all asymptotes of the rational function. And I don't know if I mentioned when these happen. I don't feel like I did. The oblique asymptotes happen when the numerator is exactly 1 degree more than the denominator. All right, so in this example here, the numerator is a degree 2, the denominator is a degree 1. If we follow the rules of horizontal asymptotes, when the numerator's degree is bigger than the denominator's, there's no horizontal asymptote. In the very special case that it's exactly one more, then there is an oblique asymptote. So there won't be any horizontals on this. There will just be an oblique and verticals. For the vertical asymptote, we're looking at setting that denominator equal to 0. So we have a vertical asymptote at x equals negative 2. The degree of the numerator is 2. The degree of the denominator is 1. So the numerator's degree is exactly 1 more than the degree of the denominator. That's what gives us an oblique asymptote. And we are doing polynomial long division. So x plus 2 is our divisor, and negative x squared plus 2x plus 3 is our dividend. So if you should have seen the polynomial long division video by now. If not, you're going to probably get confused here, please make sure you've watched the polynomial long division video, because I'm going to do this fast. I'm taking negative x squared, I'm dividing it by the leading term of the divisor, x, and I get, you know, this one was actually supposed to have a, man, I changed this one because I wanted this one to have a, oh well, no well, guys. Wait, not oh well, give me a sec. You know, I just went to all the work to change everything and then I realized like, then I'm going to have to edit this video and I simply just don't have that energy. So we're going with the example we have. That's what we're doing. We're moving forward. This wasn't the example I meant to have here, but that's okay. Leading term of the dividend divided by leading term of the divisor gives us negative x squared divided by x. So negative x. Negative x multiplied by the divisor, x plus 2, gives us negative x squared minus 2x. When we come on over here, we change the signs. So plus x squared plus 2x. 4x plus 3, leading term of the divisor of the dividend of the leftover dividend, 4x, divided by the leading term of the divisor. X gives me 4, and we can stop. It doesn't matter what the remainder is. Doesn't matter what the remainder is. The oblique asymptote is the quotient. It is not the remainder. So I don't even have to do this next step. I just need that 4. So there's an oblique asymptote at y equals negative x plus 4. So we'll just plot that line. So the y-intercept is at 4, and the slope is negative 1, down 1 over 1. Oh, well. More or less like that. Y equals negative x plus 4. When you're doing this division, you might get yourself a fraction. And if you were to get yourself a fraction, that's okay. So for instance, I guess I'm just gonna make up one over here. This is the one that I was going to write down to change the above one to, but I didn't. If you have 4x squared, minus 12x minus 15, all divided by 6x minus 9. When you go to find this oblique asymptote, because this guy does have an oblique asymptote, you would have 6x minus 9. And then the dividend, 4x squared minus 12x minus 15. Leading term of the dividend is 4x squared. Leading term of the divisor is 6x. This gives you 2/3 x. This gives you 2/3 x. And that's a little weird, right? Because when you multiply that by the divisor, you have to do a little bit of fraction math, and that's unfortunate, but we will be fine. 2/3 times 6 is 12/3, which is 4. And then x squared minus 2 times 9 is 18, divided by 3 is 6, so minus 6x. Change the signs, minus 4x squared plus 6x. You get negative 6x minus 15. Taking the new leading term of the leftover stuff, negative 6x. Dividing it by the leading term of the divisor, 6x, I get negative 1. So this guy right here would have an oblique asymptote at y equals 2/3 x minus 1. And you would plot that line just how you've plotted every other line, but you'll make it a dashed line. Asymptotes are always done with dashed lines so that they are differentiated from a graph. Anyway. This is the example I wanted to have. It doesn't matter. It's all great. In our next video, we're going to actually graph rational functions. So I'll see you in that video. It's going to be a great time. Bye.